There's a quiet understanding when we're gathered in the Spirit. It's a promise that He gives us when we gather in His name. There's a love we feel in Jesus. There's a manna that He feeds us. It's a promise that He gives us when we gather in His name. And we know when we're together, sharing love and understanding, that our brothers and our sisters feel the oneness that He brings. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus, for the way you love and feed us, for the many ways you lead us. Thank you, thank you, Lord. And we know when we're together, sharing love and understanding, that our brothers and our sisters feel the oneness that He brings. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus, for the way you love and feed us, for the many ways you lead us. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, Lord.
Jesus' parables inspire us to pray for those who forgive us, for big things and small. For those who do not forgive, no matter what. For those who do not know how to forgive. For those who do not want to forgive. For those who have not been forgiven. God of all forgiveness, we pray for them all. Amen. Teach us, God, how to treat you, how to know you, how to love you, how to learn of you, how to do as you would have us do. Teach us, above all, how to show those same things to those around us, and those whose lives meet ours, those who rub alongside us each day, and those who flit briefly by. Amen. Forgiving God, more willing to forgive than often we are to confess. Help us see our failings, to see where we fall short, to see where we deceive ourselves, where we close our eyes and ears to the ripples of our wrongdoing. May we breathe in the reality of our actions, the need to change, the depth of our unworthiness. We come before you seeking forgiveness. Now let us breathe in the power of your forgiveness and breathe out the need to live and love in the shadow of your forgiveness of us, that we may forgive as you have forgiven us. Amen. God of love and grace beyond our telling, we bring our thankful hearts to you, acknowledging that without you we are nothing, and with you we can be so much more. Thankful that you care for us and love us beyond measure, that you have endless patience with us, that you teach us time and time again what it is to be committed to you and your way. Thankful that you reveal yourself to us in myriad ways, to inspire us and invoke within us a heartful response. Thankful that while all this is for everyone who will come to you and accept you, it is for me, that I may know deep within. With overflowing hearts, hear our prayer today. Now let's end with a personal prayer together. I am not worthy, yet you love me, God. I do not deserve so much, and yet I have it. I have many needs, and before you I acknowledge them. Fill my life with your presence, that others too may come to know your healing balm. Amen.
Hello again. I wonder if you've ever heard a warning like this. Be careful what you pray for, because you might just get it. In other words, watch out, you just might get what you are after. Well, there is a prayer that many of us pray often, and it goes like this. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. You know it well. The big question to ask is this what we really want? Do we want the forgiveness of God? Of that I am quite sure the answer is yes. However, we're not so sure about the second part, about the way that we are supposed to forgive others. So let's be very real here today. We know that we are not nearly so quick to forgive others as we hope and pray that God forgives us. The psalmist says, "The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great kindness," which is great news, because we all make mistakes, we all do wrong things, we all cross the lines that God has established. We ask God for forgiveness. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, and so God forgives us. But when someone does us wrong, when someone hurts us emotionally or financially or in any other way, we say, hang on, not so fast. We are not so full of compassion and mercy. We are not so slow to anger and of great kindness. Actually, we may be quick to anger and full of some very colorful language. And yet, this is how our Lord taught us to pray. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And so I say it again, be careful what you pray for, because you just might get it. In our gospel lesson today, Peter comes to Jesus and asks him, Lord, if someone sins against me, how often should I forgive them? As many as seven times? You know, Peter always asks the questions that we would like to ask. He is so earnest. He is so eager to do the right thing. But Peter also always seems to be getting it wrong. And maybe it's his fallible humanity that makes Peter so likable, so much like you and me. He had heard Jesus talk about forgiveness, and so he wants to know more. And Peter must have done his homework too, and I think I should explain that for you today. There is an ancient rabbinic tradition that says a person should forgive another one who has sinned against him as many as four times. And so here's Peter, earnest, eager, tries to be even more extravagant than even the rabbis, and he adds three more times. And so he goes to Jesus and he says, should I forgive a person even up to seven times? Surely seven times is so much better than four times, Lord? Well, seven times is a lot. It's three more than the rabbis. It's a lot of times to turn and forgive someone who has sinned against you. Let me be transparent with you. There are things that I have done in my life that I am not proud of. I've made mistakes, and in the process I've hurt people. My fault, my responsibility, my sin. And some of those things remain to this day unforgiven. And you know what? Those are the ones that still bother me. Dr. S.I. Macmillan wrote a book many, many years ago called None of These Diseases. And in it he wrote that unforgiveness was being proven in research to make one's bones brittle. You know, I've always remembered that. And now we fast forward several decades, and Johns Hopkins Hospital today carries a website article entitled Forgiveness, Your Health Depends Upon It. And I'd like to quote to you from that article, because I think it's really instructive. Whether it's a simple spat with your spouse or long-held resentment towards a family member or friend, unresolved conflict can go deeper than you may realize. It may be affecting your physical health. The good news, studies have found that the act of forgiveness can reap huge rewards for your health, lowering the risk of heart attack, improving cholesterol levels and sleep, and reducing pain, blood pressure, and levels of anxiety, depression, and stress. And research points to an increase in the forgiveness-health connection as you grow older. The article goes on, there is an enormous physical burden to being hurt and disappointed. So says Karen Swartz, MD, director of the Mood Disorders Adult Consultation Clinic at the Johns Hopkins Hospital. Chronic anger, she says, puts you into a fight or flight mode, which results in numerous changes in heart rate, blood pressure, and immune response. Those changes then increase the risk of depression, heart disease, and diabetes, among other conditions. Forgiveness, however, calms stress levels, leading to improved health. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that worth taking note of? There's something so freeing when you say the words, "I was wrong, forgive me," and the response is a genuine and loving, "Yes, I forgive you, so let's think of this thing no more." But equally, there is something so binding, so imprisoning, when someone says, "I will never, ever forgive you for what you have done." Let's get back to the disciple called Peter. Perhaps he was expecting Jesus to praise him for even suggesting such an extravagant forgiveness. Perhaps he was hoping for a pat on the back, a gold star for the day, an A+ on his forgiveness exam. And this doesn't happen. Rather, Jesus turns and says, no, Peter, not 7 times, but 70 times 7. New Testament scholars debate whether the Greek text means 77 times or 70 times 7 times, but you know, really that's beside the point, because either way, Jesus is holding up an enormous number, a number that is so big that we can't begin to calculate it in terms of forgiveness. Try genuinely forgiving someone 490 times for the same offense, and I will bet you that it will no longer be a burning hole in your heart after a dozen attempts. Peter, you see, wants a rule, a measurement, so he holds wide his hands and says, this much, Lord? Should I forgive even this much? And Jesus says, no, much more than that. You're not even using the right scale, Peter. As far as the east is from the west, that's how much you should forgive. You know, that's such an enormous amount of forgiveness, it would be absolutely senseless to try to calculate how much or how often. So there has been a fair amount of social science research on forgiveness, and as I've already said, it turns out that forgiveness is good for you. People who forgive have lower levels of anger, anxiety, and depression, and are more agreeable and emotionally stable, and they may also have gained some health benefits. One instrument that's been designed to assess our forgiving character is known as the Forgiveness Likelihood Scale. And it gives 10 scenarios of wrongdoing and then uses the participant responses to measure a person's tendency to forgive. Here are some examples from that test. You share something embarrassing about yourself to a friend who promises to keep the information confidential. However, the friend breaks his promise and proceeds to tell several people. What is the likelihood that you would choose to forgive your friend? Or a family member humiliates you in front of others by sharing a story about you that you did not want anybody to know. What is the likelihood that you would choose to forgive the family member? And here's a third one. A stranger breaks into your house and steals a substantial sum of money from you. What is the likelihood that you would choose to forgive that stranger? Well, for you, how are you doing so far? You know, I will say this, that in my years of pastoral experience, I often come across the sweetest, nicest, most law-abiding people who are crippled by unforgiveness. They've just learned to keep it well hidden when in public. It seems as though Peter comes to Jesus with his own version of a forgiveness likelihood scale. Peter's question, Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times? Is a bit like asking, how many times, Lord, on a scale from naught to seven, must I forgive someone? And Jesus' answer, as we have seen, is literally off the scale. No, not seven times, I tell you, but 77 times or 70 times seven. And Jesus' response is a way of saying that Peter's question and what it is trying to measure is not quite right. The psalmist says, as far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our sins from us. How on earth can you give out a number on that type of forgiveness? And yet, many of us still sympathize with Peter. Lord, surely you know that there are just some things that are just unforgivable? So what is some application that we can take away with us today? Following Jesus ought to make some difference in our lives, that's for sure. Jesus tells us to forgive those who have sinned against us. He tells us to love our enemies. He says that our righteousness ought to exceed that of the scribes and the Pharisees. Well, okay, we want to follow and we are trying to do the best we can. But perhaps we would also, like Peter, like to have some benchmarks to know how we are doing. Something like this new rule of six should allow us to call us the police if we see a group of seven busted. But for most of us, sometime in our walk with the Lord, we have probably asked ourselves, am I doing this right? Am I doing this the way that Christ wants me to do it? Unfortunately, just asking that question may actually be part of the problem. The spiritual danger, you see, is that when we focus on our virtue and character strengths, we can become preoccupied with ourselves. The actual danger happens when we start thinking of our character strengths as accomplishments of our noble, virtuous, righteous selves. And that's because we can too easily slide into self-righteousness, the smug attitude that knows what real forgiveness is, who is a truly forgiving person and who is not, who deserves forgiveness and who does not, and maybe even the extent and the limits of forgiveness. Seven times seems about right. It is just too easy to forget that. To forget that while our character, strengths, and virtues may indeed glorify God, when it comes to the gospel, our Lord just doesn't deal with parts of us, the noble bits that we would like to put on display, but rather God seeks a relationship with the whole human being. Every thought, word, and deed, absolutely everything that we are and what we do. And when we remember this, none of us, saints or sinners, people who are off the charts on the forgiveness scale and those of us who are still struggling to forgive, none of us have a leg to stand on. We are all utterly dependent on the unconditional, unmerited grace and mercy of Christ, the Christ who has removed our sins as far from the east as from the west. Perhaps that's why Jesus tells Peter the story about the unforgiving servant. A story where the numbers simply don't add up, because the numbers can't be added up when it comes to what Jesus has done for us. In the story, a servant owns the king 10,000 talents. Now, we need to know that this is a crazy number. I looked it up, and today's money, one talent, was just a shade over £1 million. So we're talking about £10 billion here, which is a lot. Back then, one talent was what an average person could earn in 15 to 20 years of hard work. And so when Jesus says that the servant owed the king 10,000 talents, he's effectively saying that he owed him 10 billion quid. And he is a servant. He's not a high-flying tech entrepreneur, so no surprise that he's not even able to remotely imagine paying the debt. And so the king orders him and everything he has to be sold off. And the servant falls on his knees and begs for an extension and promises that if he gets some extra time, he'll find a way to pay everything back. Well, should we laugh or should we be filled with pity at this man? Because he can never, ever repay this large debt. Not even if he worked for 150 years of solid graft would he be able to repay. And we're not told why the king did this, but he responds to the ridiculous request with an amazing act. Since there is no way that this slave will ever be able to pay back what he owes, the king simply forgives the debt, every last penny, and sets the slave free. Imagine that. The burden of impossible debt has been removed. Wow, time to rejoice, time to be so very thankful. And yet when the servant, forgiven a debt of 10 billion pounds, is out and about soon afterwards, he comes across someone who owes him a few hundred denarii, a few pounds, less than 5 pounds. And he grabs the hapless man by the throat and he demands, "Pay up or else, today, or I'll get you." And when the king finds out, the servant, whom he has just forgiven an unimaginable amount, wouldn't forgive the pittance that was owed him by another, he has the rotten fellow thrown into prison. It's such a powerful parable, isn't it? Jesus reframes the whole question of forgiveness. He is saying that we are all just like that servant. We owe God, the King of Kings, so much more than we could ever, ever, ever repay. Sometimes we try to repay our debt via our character strengths or our virtues or our willingness to forgive as many as 7 times. But for all of that effort, we will never be able to pay back everything that we owe to God. There is good news, though. The good news is that although we can never, ever get close to repaying our debt to God, it is in His nature to forgive us, and to forgive us completely. In the life, the death, and then the resurrection of Jesus Christ, God took upon Himself all of our burdens, all of our sins, and all of our debts. And over each one of them, and all of them, He says, "This debt is paid in full, forgiven, forgotten." Think this through again today. Completely, irrevocably, utterly forgiven and healed by Jesus. Our Lord God is the God who forgives. We forgive then because God forgives. And we pass on to others the same kind of forgiveness that God has shown to us through Christ and in Christ. We're not forgivers because we are moral heroes or because we seek some kind of mental wellness. We forgive others because we know how much we have been forgiven. The forgiveness that we are able to pass on to others is the forgiveness we have in union with Christ. Never forget that. Forgiveness may well be a character strength and virtue, and it probably does contribute to good and happy lives. Some people do score higher on the forgiveness likelihood scale. But Jesus reminds us that our ability and our need to forgive is because we are all simply remorseful debtors, kneeling at the foot of the cross of the King, who wants to forgive us as soon as we ask Him. What do we pray so often in the Lord's Prayer? "Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." So be a channel of forgiveness wherever you can be one. Be a channel of healing or of restoration, of peace. And God bless all of you today.
Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light. And where there's sadness, ever joy. O Master, grant that I may never see to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving to all men that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. O Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be despair in life, let me bring hope.